Jacob Schrieber. I'm a third year graduate student at the University of Washington, where I study computer science and particularly its intersection with genome science. I'm here to talk to you today about a package I've been writing called Pomegranate, which implements flexible probabilistic modeling in Python. But before I get to that, I'd like to share a little bit about how the project evolved over the years, and in doing so, give you a bit of background about myself. The project started at the University of California, Santa Cruz. Yes, that really is the logo, the banana stock. They're trying to be rebellious in all types of ways. So basically, a coworker and I were working in a research lab, and we needed an implementation of hidden markup models. Unfortunately, we encountered a problem that I imagine many of you faced, which is that we couldn't find an implementation that had all the features we needed and could install. So we spent a great deal of time trying to install various packages and then just decided to write our own. The beginnings of Pomegranate were a cython implementation of hidden markup models called YAM, or yet another hidden markup model. We wanted to call it yet another hidden markup model that can actually install, but even the anagram of that took too many letters. So then I became a graduate student at the University of Washington. And in my first year, I was taking several machine learning courses. In the first machine learning course, we had to implement general mixture models. And I thought, what a great assignment. This is really going to help me review all of the interesting probabilistic modeling that I've learned. Then in the second class, we had to implement general mixture models. And I was far less enthused about having to do it that time. And so I thought, you know, a mixture model is really just a hidden markup model without a transition matrix. So maybe if I take YAM and I try to split it into its component parts and make it modular, I'll be able to, you know, build not just this model, but other models I'll have to build over the course of the year. So I split it into its parts, and thus Pomegranate was born, with just basic probability distributions, hidden markup models, and mixture models. Then in third class, I was glad that I'd done that, because I also had to implement general mixture models in that class as well. However, I also had to implement Bayesian networks, which are just a generalization of hidden markup models, and various other things which made me glad that I had done this. The summer after my first internship, I worked on the scikit learn team at Inrio Provider in France. This was a great learning experience for me because it taught me not just how to get the bare bones of cython efficiency out of my code, but also how to exploit multi-threaded parallelism in Python. Typically, you can't do multi-threaded parallelism because of the global interpreter lock, but if you go deep enough in cython, you're able to release that lock and do very efficient parallelism. I was fortunate in that my work with them paid off, and recently they asked me to be a core developer with them. And so now I'm working with them on their tree-based models. When I got back, I was supported through the NSF by an NSF Big Data grant through the UW eScience Institute. This is beneficial to me not just because they paid for my tuition, but also because they paid for some development of Pomegranate, and they also paid for me to go to various places and talk about it, which is great for me. I will never turn down money that's given to me to self-promote like I am tonight. So they also gave me a focus on this idea of big data, that I shouldn't just be creating models that work in the small data and medium data settings. I should be creating models that are scalable, models that where you can parallelize, where you can distribute them along computers, where you can basically deal with problems that we're inevitably dealing with now. In my second year, I had an internship with AspenTech, where I worked on their data science team, implementing various Bayesian network-related models. The work that I did with them not just helped me learn about these models, but it also resulted in some published work that came out recently that I hope to be able to get to you, I hope to be able to show you at the end of this presentation. So, if you remember only one sentence from this talk, I want it to be this one because it's a bold sentence. I want you to remember that Pomegranate can do more than other packages, it can do it faster, it's intuitive to use, and it can do all of these things in parallel. Ambitious, but hopefully by the end of this talk you'll be able to agree with me. So, in this talk I'm going to first talk about the API, and this is going to be relatively simple. Then we're going to talk about some of my favorite models that are a part of this. Lastly, I'm going to show you some examples of parallelization, and then in the finale I'm going to show you how you can train a mixture of hidden markup models in parallel, and how simple it is to do that. conveniently, I found this Wikipedia photo of pomegranate seeds and the six main models of pomegranate that correspond to the six pomegranate seeds here. So I'm taking this as a perhaps divine sign that I should stop developing pomegranate after this and just keep this slide. Or perhaps I should stop, you know, using the work of others and take my own pictures. Basically, there are six main things that, six main components to pomegranate. The first are very basic probability distributions that you're probably familiar with, like normal distributions and uniform distributions. Then we have naive Bayes, Rogoff chains, general mixture models, and other things like that. However, one of the core principles of pomegranate is that even though we have all of these various models that have different names, all of them represent probability distributions. A simple normal distribution is simple. However, a general mixture model is where you mix multiple distributions together to create a more complicated distribution. However, it has all of the statistical properties of the distribution, of a distribution, specifically that you take the integral over it, it sums only to one. Hidden Markov models represent distributions over sequences, which can be incredibly powerful. And Bayesian networks are literally probability distributions that have been factored along a graphical structure. So this is important, because if you're doing this type of thing, if you're saying that all of these really represent probability distributions, there's no reason why you shouldn't be able to mix and match and stack these things in any arbitrary way. For example, this figure shows which models can be stacked within which other models. On the left-hand side, we have the model, and on the bottom, we have that it can be stacked in that. And so we see that all of our models can be made up of simple models. You can have mixtures that may have normal distributions and so on. In dark blue, we have all of the things which I currently have implemented, and in light blue, I have all the things that I would like to soon implement. So, we're familiar with having a Gaussian mixture model, which is a general mixture model made up of multivariate Gaussian distributions. But there's no reason why you couldn't have a mixture model that's made up of hidden Markov models. If hidden Markov models are probability distributions, there's no reason why you can't just put those in. There's no reason why you couldn't put Bayesian networks in as into your mixture. There's no reason why you can't make a naive Bayes or Bayesian classifier of hidden Markov models instead of multivariate Gaussians like you might be used to doing. In comparison, this plot shows what other packages allow you to do. In dark red, we have model stacking ways you can do in pomegranate that no other package allows you to do. And in light red, we have model stacking techniques that other packages allow to some limited extent. For example, if we look at mixture models, scikit-learn implements Gaussian mixture models. So if you want to have a multivariate Gaussian distribution, you can create that very quickly in scikit-learn. But not only do we support things like Bernoulli mixtures or exponential distribution mixtures, we allow you to, in fact, stack a lot of models. And so, likewise here, HMM allows you to create hidden Markov models where you can have Gaussian mixture model emissions. But here we can have mixture models of any type. You can have mixtures of exponential distributions in your hidden Markov model, for example. I'll show some more examples of this later on. So, given that we have this uniformity about how we consider each one of our models, there is a shared API across everything. These probability distributions, of course, have a simple model for log probability or probability. If you want to generate a random sample from that, you have sample. All these models are generative, except for the Bayesian classifier. If you want to update the parameters of your model given the data, you have the fit method. If you want to use the out-of-point API, which I'll talk about in a bit, you can use summarizing from summaries. If you have compositional models, basically models that are made up of smaller models, like naive Bayes, mixture models, and so forth, you have the predict problem, predict log problem methods, which mirror what you expect if you were using scikit-learn. Then lastly, we have model.fromSamples, which is a class method that basically says that I want to create a model directly on data, and I know nothing about this model beforehand. In scikit-learn, typically you create like a naive Bayes or whatever, and then you just call .fit. But here in pomegranate, there are two ways you can initialize a model. Either you previously know the parameters of the model, and you can create it with your predefined initialization, or you want to fit it directly to data. And so from samples allows you to fit it directly to data. of these, I imagine that fit and predict are probably the most used methods, much like they're the most used methods inside of them. So, I promised I was going to get past this boring, you know, API stuff in a second, but I just wanted to show how simple this is. There are some packages where it's complicated to make even the, you know, most obvious things. If you want to define a normal distribution, you just pass it and you can sync on your data. If you want to create a Gaussian kernel density, you just pass it and you list of points. And for those who don't know, a Gaussian kernel density is basically a non-parametric distribution. And Pomegranate not only supports those as basic distributions, but supports kernel densities and other types in all of its models since it has this modular framework. And if you want to just create a normal distribution from your data instead of knowing how to call fox apps. I promise this is the last slide, I think, that's so important. So I'm going to start backing up some of my claims. First, I said that Pomegranate is fast and that it's faster than other packages. So let's compare it to NumPy. If you want to fit a normal distribution, Pomegranate is far faster. You see here that if you generate around 1,000 samples from a single dimension, it takes 22 microseconds for Pomegranate, whereas it takes 46 microseconds for NumPy. The main reason behind this is because in NumPy, you have to calculate the mean, and then you have to calculate the standard deviation. And these are two passes through the data. In addition, when you calculate the standard deviation, you have to recalculate the mean. This makes sense in the case of NumPy because NumPy is trying to be as general as possible. Whereas with Pomegranate, we know that we're trying to fit a normal distribution, and so we don't have to redo calculations that we know we're going to have to do later on. Now, I mentioned that Pomegranate is supposed to focus on big data, so generating 1,000 samples from a normal distribution is fairly trivial. Let's say we want to fit 10 million samples of 10 dimensions. We want to fit a multivariate Gaussian distribution to that. You'll see here that Pomegranate takes 800 milliseconds, whereas NumPy takes around 1 second. And the code is basically saying, again, when you calculate the covariance matrix, you do have to recalculate the mean, so you are saving some time. At this point, those who are familiar with NumPy will know that NumPy uses BLAST in the backend. And BLAST is basically computational magic that makes everything go fast. So you may be wondering, how is Pomegranate able to go as fast as NumPy if NumPy is using this computational magic? And the reason is because Pomegranate is also using this magic in the backend. That SciPy recently, I guess a year ago now, released cython level hooks to BLAST. And so Pomegranate makes use of those whenever possible in order to speed up its computations. One of the other reasons that Pomegranate is so fast is because we use summary statistics in order to update not just our distributions, but all of the models. These summary statistics allow us to go through the data only once. Instead of having to go through and calculate the mean first and then the covariance, we can calculate both of them at the same time. If you take the example of a simple normal distribution, the sufficient statistics are simply the sum of the weights, the sum of the weighted points, and the sum of the weighted points squared. If we have these three numbers, no matter how much data we've seen, we can exactly recalculate the mean and the standard deviation of that entire data set using these equations. This one makes sense that the mean is just going to be the sum of the weight points divided by the weight. Yeah. So a natural extension of this is that if we're going through with these additive summary statistics, that there's no reason we have to see the entire data set at once. If we're seeing a sample and then updating our distribution, updating our summary statistic and then moving on, we can see batches of this data. And so this exposes an out-of-port API. The idea is that basically, if we call the summarized method on some group of data, we can update our sufficient statistics based off the data in that batch, and then toss that data away. This is useful in two settings. The first setting is when you have data that doesn't fit in memory. You can only load up batches of it at a time. And the second is if you have a streaming setting, where you see data only briefly, and you have basically this infinite stream of data, and you want to keep getting better and better models without storing that data. You can see here that A basically just fits our data entirely. B uses 5 steps of the output API. And this is supposed to be a blue distribution with a red distribution superimposed. But of course, it's the same thing. And then this text down here that you can't possibly read, it basically shows the parameters that you get. And they're the same. So next, Pomegranate could be faster than SciPy. If you want to calculate the probability or log probability of a point under a normal distribution, it takes SciPy 96.3 microseconds, whereas it takes Pomegranate 560 nanoseconds. If you have a pre-created object, and you just want to calculate the probability of the next point, it only takes 119 milliseconds. And you can see in the bottom that the difference between the values calculated by Pomegranate and the values calculated by cython are basically machine precision. The reason behind this, basically, is because we use aggressive caching whenever possible in order to make everything as fast as possible. Let's take the case of the normal equation. You basically have the probability of some point under the standard deviation is equal to something. And then if you take the log of that equation, it breaks down into these two components, the log of the square root of 2 pi times sigma, and then this other thing which is data dependent. You'll notice that if you want to calculate the log probability of a point given this equation, this is the only thing that changes. This term is constant. So there's no reason why you couldn't calculate that term with some alpha beforehand. And that's exactly what Pomegranate does. When you initialize the object, it just stores this as some value. It also stores this as another value, some beta. And so when it actually comes time to calculate the probability or log probability of a point, all you have to do is a handful of additions and multiplications. Most other packages require either an exponentiation, a log, or both if they're being very inefficient. Whereas Pomegranate doesn't require any transcendental functions in order to make this calculation. So, this has been fairly dense. I figured that at this time I should move on to a real-world example, and I think that many of you will be able to identify with the example that I've chosen. And that is the case of Gossip Girl. So, a few years ago, my girlfriend was watching this show, and basically it follows a group of angsty Manhattan teens as they, you know, hook up with each other and, in general, disappoint their parents. In the background is this enigmatic figure known as Gossip Girl, who sends out these text message blasts, just in time to stir up drama. Of course, this is drama that could be solved if any of the characters talk to each other, but that's not how TV works. So, of course, immediately I was hooked. But I couldn't let her know that. So what I decided to do was say, if she helped me figure out who Gossip Girl was by the end of the first episode, then I would continue to watch with her, which she agreed. So what we did, if you decide to go through these blasts, this is an example of the first blast of the show. Spotted, lonely boy, can't believe the love of his life has returned. If only she knew who he was, but everyone knows Serena, and everyone is talking. Wonder what Blair Waldorf thinks. So they're BFFs, but we all thought Claire's boyfriend Nate had a thing for Serena. This is a terrible thing to say about anyone. And of course, it's the appropriate beginning to this show that basically focuses around this type of drama. By the end of the first episode, we have this blast. Why did she leave? Why did she return? Send me all the deets. And who am I? That's the secret I'll never tell, the only one. So this is what inspired my comment about wanting to figure out data science before she did. Because it seems exactly the type of predictive task that all of us have worked before in our daily lives. So what we did is we wanted to encode these blasts basically as being for or against a person's agenda at the time. So here, this blast says better lock it down with Nate B, Fox ticket. So this clearly is in favor of Nate's agenda, who wanted to be with Blair at the time. However, it's against Blair's agenda at the time because he was being iffy as to whether or not he wanted to be with Nate. I figured I wanted to have a broad, I wanted to talk to very broad so that not all of it was dense data science. Here's another one. S&P committing a crime in fashion. Who doesn't love a five-finger discount, especially if it's the middle one? For those of you who don't know, a five-finger discount is stealing. So this works against both of their agendas at the time because it helps them both. The idea was that if we encoded all of the blasts this way, basically somehow the person whose agenda was promoted the most in Gossip Girl would be the person who Gossip Girl was, and the people who were, and hopefully we'd be able to see if there's one clear winner. So a simple thing we could do without even having to use probabilistic modeling is just say, if I have this big matrix where the columns correspond to the characters and the rows correspond to the various blasts, and it's encoded either as +1, -1, or 0 if it's relevant, you can just take the sum. And the person with the highest sum is probably the Gossip Girl. Unfortunately, you get a graph that's basically like this, which is, has some interesting things. For example, Blair is very unlikely to be Gossip Girl, or perhaps very likely to be Gossip Girl if she's trying to, denigrate herself to maintain the secrecy. But we're not dealing with that in this model. So what we get is that Dan, Nathan, Vanessa were all tied for first place when it comes to this type of encoding. And having around 50% of the characters all being together is having the same score is not good. So we'd like to turn the probabilistic modeling to not only get a better estimate of who is most likely to be classical, but to model on uncertainty in each one of these predictions, so that we can say, either with confidence we know this character is gossip girl, or you know, we don't really know, even though one seems like it. So to do that, let's turn to the beta distribution. Basically, the beta distribution is a distribution over bits, and it goes between 0 and 1. The most common example of the beta distribution is when you're flipping a coin and you want to know what the probability of that coin coming out heads is. You can see that before you've done any flipping, you get the group distribution. It's of course a uniform distribution over all probabilities. If you haven't flipped the coin yet, then you don't know anything about you don't know anything about it. If you flip the coin twice and you get two tails, you get the cyan curve, which basically says that while the probability of it never producing heads is high, it's not zero for anything else. Maximum likelihood estimate would say that it's impossible to produce heads at this point. Whereas here it only shows that it's most likely to produce heads. Something that's interesting about the beta distribution is that the first time you see a head, instead of the mode of the distribution being zero, now it's impossible for it to be zero, which corresponds to not being able to produce heads. This makes sense intuitively, because once you've seen a head, it's impossible that this point can produce heads. Then as you see more data, it seems like it converges to basic data. The middle, it seems like it basically forms like Gaussian. So, what we're going to do is turn back to gossip graph. And we now have a whole bunch of blasts that we either code as plus one or some of the agenda, or minus one against that agenda. So let's feed that into all these big distributions. And what we end up having is that J on the left hand side is the least likely to be gossip graph. The vertical lines show the maximum likelihood estimates based off the beta distribution, whereas the curves show the actual distribution themselves. Whereas Dan in green seems like the most likely to be gossip girl based just based on season one. As we progress through the season, we see two trends which are kind of expected. The first is that these distributions converge to be tighter, which makes sense. As you get more data as the season progresses, you're going to get better estimates as to which one is most or least likely to be gossip girl. Unfortunately, what happens is that in the first one, we have very clear separation between many of these distributions. But as we get to season four, the distributions have converged to be very overlapping. And this is one of the reasons why we use probabilistic modeling. Because while you might initially say, hey, look, Dan has the highest maximum likelihood value, you can see that this distribution overlaps a great deal with the other distributions that came out of the content. This makes sense because apparently what happened is that the source creators had no idea what the gossip girl was going to be. They figured they just kind of pulled it out of the hat. Then the show got canceled, but they didn't have enough time to kind of stitch together. And they just picked one of the characters randomly. And spoiler alert, it ended up being Dan. So this type of probabilistic modeling was able to actually identify some trend in the data, some unconscious bias that the writers had to favoring Dan's agenda. So that's my exciting example for the talk. Let's jump back into Pomegranate. But I felt like before I went into the models, I needed to motivate the idea of probabilistic modeling before getting into the various models and computers. So the first one I'm going to talk about is general mixture models. The one I have met several times. Basically, in every one of my machine learning classes, I have the table. The idea is that typically, you'll encounter data that doesn't neatly fit any one distribution. You might encounter data that looks like this. But in this case, it doesn't look like it neatly fits one normal distribution. It seems like there are two normal distributions there, and we'd like to model both of them. So, what we do is we create this mixture of two normal distributions. If you want to create the code, all you need is this. Our general mixture model, you define the type of distribution you'd like to use, and then you define the number of columns. Then you just fit to your data, and you end up with a PDF that looks like this. And this seems like it fits fairly well, that not only are you capturing the parameters of the two normal distributions, you're capturing the weight of each one of them. Because it seems like there are far more points here than there are there. It would be unfair to say that this is a bimodal normal distribution. So, it is a bimodal normal distribution where each one of the distributions is of equal weight. The general mixture models are good for that where you have some unknown data distribution that has multiple components and you don't have any labels. That's the important part, because this is unsupervised. The Murdoch, typically you'll have Gaussian mixture models. So I've learned, for example, have a very good implementation of Gaussian mixture model. But there's no reason why you have to be limited to Gaussian. You can use any type of distribution as long as it exposes a probability method or fit method. Here, you see data which might initially look like it comes from an exponential distribution. However, if you try to fit an exponential distribution in this data, we get a curve which looks like this, which is unfortunate because it seems like it underpredicts at the very left-hand side, and then it overpredicts at the middle part there. So, an exponential distribution itself wouldn't be very good. Instead of turning to trying to find some even more complicated single distribution we could use here, let's define a mixture of two exponential distributions. One of which decays very rapidly in the beginning, and one of which decays very slowly. So all we have to do is, instead of finding global distribution down here, we pass in exponential distribution. That's the only change you have to make. And you get a PDF which looks like this. It looks like it fits far better than the single exponential distribution. And that makes sense because I drew this data from two exponential distributions. In addition, you don't even talk about homogeneous mixtures. Mixtures where each one of the components follow the same distribution. But there's no reason why you have to do that. You can have mixtures of arbitrary distributions. And so in this case, we're mixing an exponential distribution with a uniform distribution. Because we're thinking maybe this tail is uniformly distributed, then there's exponential decay at the very beginning. Unfortunately, it seems like this distribution kind of sucks. So this isn't exactly something that you should do all the time. It's simply what you can do. In general mixture models are faster inside of them. Here we're looking at multivariate Gaussian distributions. What we have is on the y-axis is the number of times faster Pomegranate inside of them. Purple on the top, we have prediction speed. And in cyan at the top, we have fitting speed. So it seems like as we increase the number of dimensions that we're dealing with, we go from about being 3 times faster inside of them to being about twice as fast in fitting the Gaussian. At the bottom, we have the accuracy of this. And unfortunately, accuracy is a bit ill-defined for unsupervised problems like this. And in fact, these giant spikes are caused by some initialization issues that Pomegranate has had, which have since been fixed. So hopefully, you shouldn't see these giant spikes. While still getting them. So next, let's talk about hitting lookup models, which are really the flagship implementation that Pomegranate is based on, because that's how the entire project started. Basically, instead of going through each one of these features independently, I thought I'd just create a giant table comparing Pomegranate to each member of the other most feature form of implementation in the markup model that I know of for Python. I passed this table to the core developer of HTML here, and he seemed to agree with its accuracy. I tried to be as generous as possible, but, not the same as myself. So what we have are things on the left column, the things that Pomegranate has implemented, and on the right, the things that has implemented as well. So here are the things which I think are the most important parts of this table. Pomegranate has a sparse implementation that speeds up all of the calculations it's doing if you have some sort of sparse graph structure. If you have a dense graph structure, it doesn't matter because you're doing just as many calculations as you would in the linear matrix multiplication. Pomegranate is flexible because it allows you to put arbitrary omissions on each one of your states. Instead of defining that all of them have to be Gaussian distribution, you can say that some of them are Gaussian, but perhaps some distributions are more complicated, so instead you represent by a mixture model. And so both of them share that you can have discrete Gaussian and Gaussian mixture model omissions, but Pomegranate has a larger library of other omissions. For example, I know that there's a group somewhere in the tundra of Canada that's using cython distributed HMMs to model gradient lookup. And then here we have tidy missions, which basically I find important because typically you might have a phenomenon which can occur several times in the model, but due to the structure you're trying to implement, you don't want to have each one of these phenomena. All these phenomena correspond to the same parameters, and you want to enforce that. This can vastly reduce your parameterization and give you better estimate. And lastly, multithreaded parallel training. Like all methods in Pomegranate, it can help a lot. And I'll show you an example of that. So I was mentioning the stacking, that you can do stacking where you put a distribution inside a general mixture model. You put that general mixture model inside each map. And since all of them are distributions, there's no reason why you couldn't. I figured I'd show you an example of actually doing that in the code. And you can see that what you first do is you first define your general mixture model and pass all your distributions. That should take D1 and D2 for the first bit, going off a little bit. Then the next one, S1, S2. What you're basically doing is that instead of putting a normal distribution in this state, you're putting this general mixture model. Then, you're just passing that in as you would before. And all you have to change if you wanted to switch this from a mixture model to a normal distribution is just change D1 and D2 and the remainder of the code stays the same. In other packages, you might have to define that you want, say, to build specifically a GMM HMM versus a Gaussian HMM or something. Whereas here, you don't have to explicitly say anything. So if you compare the speed of Pomegranate versus the speed of HMM, then we get some very promising results. That in green at the bottom, we have the Viterbi algorithm, which is often used for decoding. That seems like they're around the same speed for that. I'm not entirely sure why, but regardless, the best of them, as we increase the number of components of our model, the number of nodes in our graph, we see that we get faster and faster than HMM. And this is a byproduct of the sparse implementation of hidden markup models that Pomegranate has. That if we're increasing the size of our components, as long as they aren't densely connected, we get huge speed gains just by not doing matrix multiplies when the majority of the entries in that matrix is zero. So lastly, let's go to Bayesian networks. How much time do I have left? Any more? Okay. Great, because now I have hours and hours to talk about Bayesian networks and not video. So Bayesian networks are a recent infatuation of mine. I really enjoy them, even though I'm around 2 decades too late to be on the cutting edge or make any significant progress in the field. Basically, the way that Bayesian networks work are that they define the dependency structures between your variables. That your variables here are your nodes, and edges represent dependencies between the variables, and a lack of an edge represents a conditional independence. Conditional independence, not independent, which is important. These allow inference to happen really easily because of the explicitly defined dependencies. So what I have here is an example of a diagnostic network. It has 3 layers, not to be confused with like a neural network having layers. This Bayesian network just happens to have layers. Where on the bottom we have symptoms. We have low energy, bloating, loss of appetite, vomiting, and abdominal cramps. In the middle, we have 3 conditions that we want to model: ovarian cancer, lactose intolerance, and pregnancy. On the top, we have 3 genetic conditions. The first 2 are mutations in the BRCA1 or 2 genes, and the next is the mutation in the LCT gene. These dependencies make sense. That having a mutation in the LCT gene is going to be very predictive if you're going to have lactose intolerance. However, these backwards connections also make sense. That it's not that vomiting, indicates pregnancy. It's that pregnancy indicates vomiting. That's the flow of inference that you want to be able to model. So there are 2 main tasks involving a Bayesian network. The first is that you want to be able to do inference given incomplete information. And one of the powerhouses of Bayesian networks is that you don't need to define which variables you're going to observe and which ones are going to be hidden in advance. If you're training, say, a logistic aggressor and support vector machine or whatever, you're saying, I always see all my features, and then I try to predict this one specific feature. So if you're dealing with an implementation where you have missing values, then you're still trying to predict some specific variable. Here, what you're saying is that here's the dependency structure between all variables. As I get more information about what I should set these variables to, I know more about the other variables. It can be completely arbitrary, and so it can be very powerful. So, let's say that I'm a doctor, and I want to know what is the basically marginal probability of each one of the patients who I see walking in with each one of these conditions. We get those probabilities here by just running what's called the sum product algorithm over the Bayesian network and not observing any data. So these are basically baselines or marginal probabilities. That there's a 0.1% chance that a person walks in with the BRCA1 mutation. There's a 10% chance they walk in with a pregnant. And these are all determined based based on the parameters of the discrete distributions and conditional probability tables that you define. I just initialize these to random but seemingly appropriate numbers, so these numbers aren't derived from your data. However, this person walks in, you're talking with them, and they say that they have low energy, they are bloating, and they are vomiting, and you want to know which condition they have. You can see that the probability of ovarian cancer jumped from being very low before to being 91% now. That previously it was 0.5%, and after you've observed this data, it's now 91%. And so at this point, not only can you say, hey, I think it's ovarian cancer, what you can say is, I know what tests I should run in order to confirm this. I should run BRCA1 and BRCA2 genetic tests, because those will give us more insight into whether or not this person has ovarian cancer. That's a very awful diagnosis, and so you probably want to be more than 91% sure before you give it. The other task is structure learning. The idea is basically I have some data set and I want to learn the dependencies between these variables without knowing anything. Unfortunately, the naive structure learning task is super exponential in time. We see that in blue here, that even as you get to like 6, 8 variables with a good implementation, it's going to take more time than you want. But when you get like 10 or 12, is it possible? Then later on, a new method based on parent independence came out, which was still super exponential, but it was a bit faster. And it relied on building a giant cache. Unfortunately, this cache was super exponential in size, so you've kind of traded super exponential in time to super exponential in memory, which isn't a very good trade-off in many cases. Then, around 4 or 5 years ago, someone came up with a dynamic programming algorithm, which basically said that if I'm considering the parent set of these variables over here, that's not going to influence how well I'm scoring the variables on this other side of the graph, which makes total sense, but no one had figured it out because it involved multiple optimizations over two separate lattices. But he figured it out, and he reduced it from super exponential to simply exponential. And I have to admit that when I heard that phrase the first time, you know, it surprised me, because it's rare that you see someone describing something as simply exponential in time. And so then the Pomegranate implementation of this, which uses another efficiency, is shown in purple, that you can get a little around order of magnitude speed gain on that, but it's still going to be exponential. So Pomegranate currently supports 4 different structure learning algorithms for Bayesian networks. 2 of them are kind of the same. One of them is based off of the dynamic programming algorithm ends up formulating the structure learning problem as a shortest path algorithm. And so if you have a shortest path algorithm, you can either use the more naive finding the shortest path through a graph by dynamically considering all possible edges, or you can use ASMR search in order to more smartly search through this graph to find the algorithm. And so both of those are implemented just in case you don't trust my ASMR search implementation. It seems to improve things around, around 30% or so. Then, while I was working on this, I happened to stumble upon a novel greedy algorithm, which basically greedily builds the topological ordering of the variables while optimally identifying the parents of those variables given that. And this is this reduces the time down to quadratic time and can produce very good graphs. On the left-hand side, we have the time, and here is the log probability of the data given this as we increase the number of variables. Last method is the childhood tree, which is incredibly fast because it's basically building a tree approximation of the data. Tree approximations are good for building a like first pass understanding of what's going on, but they aren't very good in that typically variables might have more than one parent. So what you can see here is that childhood is incredibly fast. However, it produces the worst graphs, graphs with the worst log probability. Here we have the blue and the magenta line superimposed because they're both finding the exact optimal graph. And in green we have the greedy algorithm, which, given the amount of time it's taking, is producing fairly good graphs. And so that's the default in Pomegranate. The main reason it's the default in Pomegranate is because the exact algorithm will usually top out at around 25 to 30 variables. In terms of the amount of time you want to wait. And so I figured that instead of killing your computer with an almost impossible task if you happen to use more variables, that I'd give you a greedy approximation first and allow you to choose to use the exacto method if you desire. So, I mentioned at the beginning that my work with Aspen Tech resulted in some research and a publication. And this is basically with the idea, I developed the idea of constraint graphs. And the idea behind the constraint graph is that if we're approaching this Bayesian structure learning problem, typically we do have some data about the variables. It's not very clear information, but we'll have some vague information about what types of structures can exist or what types of structures can't. Let's consider this diagnostic network again. We basically have three layers. The first are genetic conditions, the middle are diseases, and the bottom are symptoms. If we had some big graph with hundreds of symptoms, diseases, and genetic conditions, we don't want to produce a graph where one disease causes another disease, or some genetic condition is linked to some genetic condition. We want to produce a graph where the only edges that can exist are from genetic conditions to diseases, and from diseases to symptoms. This drastically reduces our search space. And so instead of wanting to do the exact algorithm and then throw out any possible, any offending graphs, we want to take that into account in the search space. And this, if you end up having a, and so this produces a constraint graph that seems like this, where the constraint graph is basically defined over sets of the variables. You have this set of genetic conditions, you have this set of diseases, and you have this set of symptoms. And then you define the possible edges that can exist by having edges between these sets. So, if you have an acyclic constraint graph like that, you can reduce the amount of time that it takes to find the optimal structure from exponential to quadratic in time. And that could be a pretty massive gain. And so you'll have a setting like this where you define a bunch of your variables as being genetic conditions, a bunch of them being diseases, and a bunch of them being symptoms. And you want to learn your Bayesian over this, subject to the constraint graph that you've defined. So if you do this, you can see some very drastic savings. What I implemented was the exact algorithm which filtered out all the things that offended prior knowledge versus just using the constraint graph. So this is the amount of time that it takes. You can see the exact search does take exponential time as you would expect, whereas this takes quadratic time, it searches over far fewer structures. So I thought, why not extend this to making money? So I decided to model the global stock market. What I did is I took the opening and closing prices of the top 20 stocks on the Tokyo Stock Exchange, the British Stock Exchange, and the New York Stock Exchange. And what we have are the opening prices in green and the closing prices in red. And I said, I wanted to find a constraint graph that looks like the one up there. Because I know the Tokyo Stock Exchange opens in the morning. And I'm not going to try to model between days, because that's going to be impossible for a single Bayesian to do. So I'm just going to model a single day. So the Tokyo Stock Exchange opens at the beginning, and the opening prices of the Tokyo Stock Exchange are going to influence the closing prices of the Tokyo Stock Exchange. But the opening prices of the Tokyo Stock Exchange will also influence the opening prices of the British Stock Exchange. It won't influence the closing the opening prices of the New York Stock Exchange, because it closes before the New York Stock Exchange opens. So, we end up with a structure like this, where basically markets only influence other markets that are open at the time that they either open or close. And what this ends up giving is, I think, there are around 120 variables, which would be impossible to learn a normal Bayesian over. But here, using this constraint graph, it only takes 2 seconds. So, and this is the densest slice of the Bayesian that's learned. And you can see some interesting things that make sense and some other things that don't make sense. But it's more meant as a timing thing.
But you'll have continuous dependency, right? Throughout the day, one market continues to affect the other market.
Yeah, so all I'm modeling here are just the opening and the closing prices, not the current.
That's the approximation that you made.
Yeah.
Okay.
You could have a more complicated one where you are modeling the current price based off of the other ones.
And in your previous one, the number of variables is the number of symptoms or all the nodes, including diseases?
All of the nodes.
All of the nodes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Show how you can do parallelization. I'm in the process of making it so you can just pass an n jobs parameter to each one of these functions, which would of course be the most intuitive. But in the meantime, I've implemented parallelization wrappers for that can take in any model and just handle it appropriately for now. So if you want to do predict, instead of calling model.predict, you would call the predict function we pass in the model with the data set and number of jobs. You can see that it takes about the same to use the function as it takes to use the method, and then it's about twice as fast to use four jobs. I don't know of any other package that allows you to do parallel prediction, though they do allow, several others do allow you to do parallel fitting. And you can see here that you don't have to worry about race conditions or ordering of the data. It'll return the, as expected, it will return the labels in the same order that you fed the data set in. So it's a complete match. Regardless of the parallels. Likewise, if you want to do, if you want to predict the probability instead of just the label, you get around 2x speed improvement by using 4 jobs. And there's no difference, even at like machine precision, between the numbers that are produced by using parallelization or not. Then lastly, I said I would show you how to create a mixture of HMM and training in parallel. But this is basically all the code that you need in order to create a mixture of HMMs. You have some function, in this case I'm calling it create profile HMM because this is from my research as an undergrad. It basically just returns some hidden markup model. So you have these three hidden markup models. You just pass them into general mixture model. Instead of passing in normal distribution, you just pass them in the whole hidden markup model because it's still a distribution. Then you're done with that. And since you have a general mixture model, which is still just a distribution, even though it's a very complicated one, you can just call dot fit. And when you do dot fit with an increasing number of threads, you can see the time that it takes to train this whole mixture. So you see the most gain when you go from one thread to two thread, of course, and then it seems to max out when it goes between the 8 and 9 threads. And the reason that it doesn't continue going down is because ultimately I'm using Cython and not C++, and so I do have to keep going back and forth between the Cython layer and the Python layer, and that's going to have an overhead that's going to be basically normal. So, like I said at the beginning of the talk, Pomegranate can do more than other packages. It can do it faster, it's intuitive to use, and it can do all of this in parallel. Thank you for your time.
I'm really curious. I noticed you mentioned of markup chains at the beginning. Could you say a little something about that? It looked like from those matrices that maybe that was a work in progress or not fully available, or how's it compared to say like PyMC, for example?
I'm not. So let me clear up something which could be a misconception. There's a difference between probabilistic modeling and Bayesian modeling. This package does probabilistic modeling, but it uses maximum likelihood estimates, whereas things like PyMC use Bayesian statistics. The major difference between those is that here, our distributions have fixed parameters. Like our normal distribution has a mean that's a number, whereas in Bayesian modeling, you'll have your mean be some other distribution in order to allow you to model more ranges and things. So Pomegranate does not support Bayesian statistics in that sense, which is confusing because it supports Bayesian networks, and most people aren't familiar that there are normal Bayesian networks and Bayesian networks, which support Bayesian statistics. But as for your original question, which is how supporting markup chains, not very well supported at this time. Basically, the idea is that you can create a markup chain, all of the methods that I mentioned are supported in the sense that you can create it directly from data, you can fit into new data, you can calculate probabilities from the sample. It currently only works in the discrete setting, and you basically end up just passing in a list of first a univariate distribution representing the first character, then a sequence of conditional tables saying passing in the current character and the previous k for a k option. Also, for people who are, like you who are interested in specific methods, if you go to the GitHub page here, I do have a folder called tutorials, and each one of the models that I have has a tutorial, and so you can see what's currently available and how we can use it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Does trying to remember, do markup models utilize Gibbs sampling?
Again, if you were using Bayesian, if you do Bayesian statistics, you would use something like Gibbs sampling. Here we're just using maximum likelihood estimate, so there's no sampling at all.
Also, is there a way to detect, to use Pomegranate to detect outliers, or these models aren't sensitive to that?
Off the top of my head, I can't think of a way to do that. But if there are general ways for detecting outliers using any one of these methods, then you should be able to. I guess you could if you use a line-based classifier where you had a normal distribution representing the, you know, the probability distribution of normal data, then some other much longer distribution representing the outliers. Then you can use the line-based classifier to classify something as an outlier.
And also, is there any plan, not to put homework on your plate, is there any plan to port this to R? I'm sure you're not crazy about that question.
So, this has been brought up before. Specifically, I was talking with the developers about XNet, and they were telling me that the fastest way to get more people to use this is to port it over to R and various other languages, because then you automatically get those user insights. My professional opinion on this is that I don't have enough time to pour expertise in order to do that. My personal opinion is I don't like to do that.
Curious with the Bayesian networks, like how quickly does that like scale up, like as far as consumption of memory? Do
you mean to find it or the various
networks? I mean, like if you wanted to say do like thousands or something like that, would that just be something that just quickly blow up your memory and your computer, or would you eventually be able to train it on size, like a lot of
Yeah, so there are multiple, there are different answers depending on which algorithm you need. If you need just fitting a predefined Bayesian data, that scales almost infinitely, because it's very easy to fit parameters around. If you wanted to do inference, that scales not as well as calculating for me, updating the parameters based on data, so calculating log probability or doing inference will scale. Learning the structure of the network from data does not scale well. Like I mentioned, that doing it exactly is going to be exponential. And that's going to top out at around 25 variables. Using the greedy algorithm is probably going to top out at around 100 to 250 variables. Using child root trees will not top out. So if you want to build a child root tree, you can use thousands of variables. It's just that it won't be available. Exciting.
Maybe it's a wrong question. You haven't thought of actually just doing the same work for scikit-learn itself, extending. Could your parallelization be implemented for scikit-learn libraries?
In theory, parallelization can be added to scikit-learn. And many scikit-learn models are parallelized, specifically like random forest are parallelized. K-means initialization of GM are parallelized. Just training one model itself, it would require a huge amount of work in order to change much of the scikit-learn code over, because you have to change it down to cython. You have to go down to the cython level, you have to release the global interpreter. Scikit-learn, several of the methods are written entirely in Python and use numpy. And so it would be very difficult to parallelize them, because you have to rewrite them from scratch, where a Pomegranate was built from the ground up, keeping in mind the idea that I want to get the memory inside. Yeah.
Same problem on the relationship with parallelism.
Okay, well, if there are no other questions, then thank you for your time.